Well. Hello, everybody. What a day, right?
I'm not even getting into the pineapple tonight. I'm on coffee because it has been a very, 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 very long week, and I am very, 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 very tired. But we have tonight. Let's see. Where's that? This. We're going to do an unboxing. From Kansas City, home of the Super Bowl champions. Congratulations to the Kansas City Chiefs for their eking out a win in the Super Bowl today. Which, of course, you know, Super Bowl is copyright trademark, the National Football League. All right, so we got this late last week, Friday, I think. It's a box, it's an envelope. It's not a box, it's an envelope. It's from Zondervan Publisher, so I'm fairly certain it's going to be a book. So let us open. See what we can see. It is a book. It is a book called Fractured Tide. Bum ba dum. My author, Leslie Lutz. Have never heard of this author. All right, so let's see what this. See what this story is about. We'll put that right there. Let's see. Fractured Tide. Lost meets Stranger Things in this eerie, immersive. okay. I have to do a voice then. Lost meets Stranger Things in this eerie, immersive YA thriller, thrusting 17-year-old Sia into a reality where the waters in front of her and the jungle behind her are as dangerous as the survivors alongside her. Bum, bum, bum.
Okay, so. okay. So, I guess. Sia, I'm assuming that's how it's pronounced. She takes people out diving, and apparently a dive goes badly. Reef exploring the reef, uncovers secrets locked in a sunken shipwreck craft. Attacked by a mysterious creature, Sia's boat is sunk, her customers are killed, and she washes up on a deserted island with no sign of rescue in sight. Waiting in the water is a seemingly unstoppable monster that is still hungry. In the jungle, just off the beach, our danger is best left untested. This is an interesting little, interesting book. Yeah, maybe. I'm going to turn that off so we don't get distracted. All right. Leslie, about the author. The author on the back there. Leslie Karen Lutz is a devoted fan of scuba diving and creature horror. Her writing has appeared in various journals, including Orca Literary Journal, Catterskill Basin Literary Journal, Typhusly, Number One, The Lyric, and Raintown Review. She lives in Fort Worth, my old stomping grounds, is a member of International Thriller Writers, Horror Writers Association, Editorial Freelancers Association, as the DFW Writers Workshop. Okay. Fractured Tide won the 2018 Frisco First Chapter Contest. So there we go. This is released May 5th, 2020 in hardcover. I did not get a hardcover, obviously. This is an advanced reading copy, early proof, so there may be some... Oh, and it's got water illustrations there. So... They don't animate, though. It's the same one. All right. Did I just yawn on camera? I'm sorry. All right. Okay. So, there we are. A book to add to the other pile. Here, I'll show you. All right. I'll do this here. Because we have other books. Let's see. I have Wonder Woman 750, which I have read. It's okay. They could have done better. But that George Perez cover, right? I've also got one from Adam Hughes, and it's back there. The Hadley Academy for the Improbably Gifted. I have read it. I need to do a review of it. That's coming at some point. This book we got last week, Will McCarthy, The Collapsium. I have not read it yet. I need to. Star Trek The Next Generation, Available Light from Dayton Ward. I have read it. I need to write a review. I haven't yet. Oh, I just hit. Okay, hold on. All right, we're good. Combat Frame X Seed by Brian Niemeyer. I have read it. I need to write a review. Bent Heavens by Daniel Krauss. I have not read it yet. I need to. Halfway Home by Hugh Howey. I have not read it yet. I need to. All right. So there's that pile. And then we have these from TKO that I still have, pound for pound. The Banks and Eve of Extinction. I still have all of this stuff to read and review. And somewhere in there, I have 7 TV shows to produce on a regular basis and 2 more in the works. At some point, we're going to get them out and do stuff with them. But I have been tied up because I've been doing a lot of sports, a lot of freelance work. one of the things that I do as part of my work is I work for ESPN, ABC, Fox every now and again when they do. College sports, done college football. Right now it's college basketball. So what I do is I'm part of the local crew that gets hired to help augment and supplement the network crew that comes in, and they bring the trucks in and we run all the cables, so all power cables and video cables and IT and control cables and all these different things. Then we help, you know, the camera crews during the game and all that. And then we take it all apart and pack it up in the truck, and they go away. Well, I've been doing a lot of that lately. Part of that because we've got to save up money for Star Wars Celebration and C2E2, which is coming up very soon. So, you know, this is the job. This is the work that I do. And so I've been out at Kansas State, which is a 2-hour drive out. And then University of Kansas, which is about a half hour from here, for basketball games. And so I'm very tired. I was not at the KU game where the brawl busted out a couple of weeks ago. I missed that one, fortunately. But nobody got hurt, which is good as far as any of the TV crew or anything. So, but that's one of the day job things that I do, and I'm going to be doing that tomorrow. So I will be. So that's why we're doing H2O on Thursday. How do I feel that the Kansas City Chiefs won? Benjamin, that's a good question. And it's fine. I mean, I live here in Kansas City now, so it's satisfying to be able to sit there and say, hey, you know, we've got another Super Bowl under our belts. I'm originally from Dallas, so growing up, I was a fan of the original Dallas Cowboys, so the Tom Landry era of the Cowboys. I was not happy with Jerry Jones and his. Jerry Jones has never impressed me. Jerry Jones is impressed with himself a lot, it seems. But I've never been a big sports person. I played when I was a kid. I played soccer. I played baseball. I played basketball. So it's fun to be at the basketball games. So I've played enough that I can appreciate the game at least. But I've never been a big sports fan, and this is the first Super Bowl that I've watched in a number of years. Now, for a long time, I watched for the commercials, and then those got lame and disappointing, and you get all of the commercials get spoiled because they show up on YouTube before they show up in the game. So I haven't had any reason to watch. This year, we had a reason to watch. We got together with some friends and we went out and we watched the game, and it was fun. It's fun to watch. It's, you know, part of that is when you're at an event, whether it's a sports thing or, you know, this actually kind of gets into the rest of my topic today, whether it's a sports thing or whether it's a Comic-Con or whether it's even a political thing, when, you know, the energy from the people around you kind of feeds into that. So, you know, watching the Chiefs come back from behind is always satisfying, because it's almost, I don't want to say it's a given, but they have a track record of doing that. So everybody, a lot of people in Kansas City are very, very, very happy that the Chiefs won. And it's really weird how the whole thing lined up. They were talking about it in the pregame about the palindromes that are surrounding this, you know, 0202 on 2020, and it's Andy Reid's 222nd win, and it's, you know, it's 50 years from the time they won the last Super Bowl that they were in, and it's 100 years of the game. It's, you know, all of these different milestone things, these moments that kind of line up. So it's really interesting to see how all of that plays into the win for tonight. So, and I've got a friend of mine that she's a dance studio teacher. She's a dance teacher in Dallas now. She was a Kansas City Chief cheerleader. So, you know, there's appreciation there. I can appreciate the Chiefs winning the Super Bowl. It's a big deal. It's a huge thing. And, you know, here in Kansas City, when the Royals won the World Series here a few years ago, I mean, this town turns out, and I imagine probably for the rest of the week, it's going to be just crazy around here. There's nothing officially planned, but people are talking about some sort of a parade on Wednesday, which is fine. I don't get out very much. I stay in the house. I stay in the, you know, I'm at the house. I'm at the office. I don't get out very much. Because I sit at this computer and I edit video or I write scripts or do whatever. But yeah, it's pretty cool. We've got a Super Bowl team. You know, world champion football team, and the Royals won the World Series here a few years ago. So Kansas City is on the map. There are a lot of people that are noticing. And from a media production standpoint, this is something that's been a big draw here for the last couple of years. People that come in for reality shows, film productions, and TV shows, and such. They're very impressed with the resources that Kansas City has in terms of crew, in terms of people that can work on those shows, the kind of equipment that they need, the locations that they need. You know, Kansas City, and we talked about this a little bit last week on H2O when we were talking about our movie. There are a lot of pockets in and around the Kansas City metropolitan area that can pass for other parts of the country, other parts of the world. We've got a little strip of townhomes downtown in Kansas City that look like Boston, for example. You know, there's rivers and there's lakes and there's all sorts of different architecture around this area. So you can very easily shoot Kansas City as, say, Gotham City or New York or Chicago or whatever. And it's a selling point for Kansas City. And the people that keep coming in, you know, the production people that come in, they're always so impressed and they're surprised and they're like, oh wow, I didn't know it was like this. Kansas City is, I don't want to say it's a hidden gem in terms of being the kind of city where things can get done. I mean, we don't have a whole lot of permits that have to, you know, you don't have to have a whole lot of permits to make films here. Unlike Los Angeles, where you're throwing money out left and right to all sorts of things for all sorts of different reasons. We don't have that kind of thing here. The culture here in Kansas City is very relaxed. So yeah, it lends itself to a lot of things happening here. And I think people are starting to notice. So over the last couple of years, there's been a big push. And we got our film incentives back in the state legislature, so you can offer tax rebates and whatnot to the various different productions that come into town. I know a lot of people are upset that Ozark is not actually shot in the Ozarks. You know, stuff like that. There's been a big push, a big strong aggressive push to get more production to come here to the state of Missouri, but you know, especially in the Kansas City area. And then, of course, you know, you've got the World War One Museum, which is unique here. You've got the NCAA basketball experience and, you know, things. So there are a lot of things that Kansas City has to offer in terms of culture and entertainment and that sort of thing. So, oh, well, congratulations. You won $250 on the game. I am not a gambler myself, but congratulations. Well done. I read somewhere that somebody had put a $10,000 bet or a $100,000 bet on the Chiefs and blew the spread or whatnot. I'm not sure. I think I looked in this thing. But it strikes me, there's a big parallel here. Since this channel here, you know, we're based in Kansas City, and you know, I tweeted out earlier that, you know, it's, you know, we've been here since 2009 in Kansas City, home of the champions, home of the Chiefs. But it strikes me, and this is something that that I've noticed before, and I've kind of touched on a little bit, but the parallels in fandom is something that we don't really talk about a whole lot. Now, junior high school, we were growing up, the athletes are always picking on the geeks and the nerds. The athletes always picking, you know, that's the stereotype, right? And, you know, you have movies like Revenge of the Nerds and that sort of thing. But these two groups really ought to be getting along a whole lot more than the stereotype will paint them. And I'm gonna acknowledge the stereotype and use that as my starting point. Because, you know, when you're growing up, the other things that, you know, the difference between the jocks and the smart kids, the brains, you know, it's always something that's commented on and it's played with, you know, in the entertainment, you know, in the movies and all this. It's that look, that trope, that the jocks and the nerds don't get along until they have to defeat the monster or whatever. Benjamin, we're going to be at C2E2, so if you make it, look for us. We'll see what we can do. But yeah, so here's a thing. You have professional football teams, and those professional football teams all have fans. So let's start there. Excuse me. Let's say that the Kansas City Chiefs are like Star Trek. And say maybe the Tennessee Titans are Star Wars. And the Dallas Cowboys are Battlestar Galactica. I mean, the parallel. A team. You've got this fandom over here that has a team, and they follow the team, and they're big fans of the team. And then over here you have fans of a show, whether, you know, it's brown coats who like Firefly, and you've got Gators who are into Stargate. You've got Trekkies. You've got Jedi and Sith. You've got the Star Wars group. You have Whovians, and they have their brand loyalty. They have their particular team that they root for. They certainly maybe appreciate the others, but they have that one that's they like just a little bit more than the others. And over here in your sports, you have the same kind of thing. You have your team. You have your favorite players. You have your favorite, you know, personalities that are part of this. They're celebrities. They get paid a lot of money to do what they do because they're very good at what they do. And same thing over here. You have thank you for the super chat, Mimi Katz. I appreciate that. Welcome to the chat. We have you know, actors that we follow, people like William Shatner or Michael Shanks or, you know, Tom Welling, you know, people that we follow from show to show to show. You know, back in the day, it was Jonathan Franks and Marina Sirtis. Yeah, we're on Star Trek: The Next Generation. Then we're on Gargoyles, and you pay attention to those kind of things, and we even do you know, follow writers and directors, and we pay attention to that sort of thing. And it's just like the sports fans; they pay attention to the coaching staff, and you know, the front office people and management. We pay attention to this kind of thing. You know, we look at the network. You know, we all pay attention to what Mark Pedowitz is saying over at CW, because Mark Pedowitz is a big fan of the CW Arrowverse and all that. These are parallels. And of course, we have events. We have big comic cons and comic book conventions and horror conventions and big things. And they have, you know, sports fans have events too. They have crowds and they have big groups that get together and big, you know, big event type things. You know, there's a parallel. I guess you could say that our Super Bowl is San Diego Comic-Con. It's the big one. It's the huge, big event. And you've got New York Comic-Con. You've got FanX Salt Lake. And then you've got your smaller ones. You've got, you know, Fan Expo Dallas. You've got C2E2. You've got Star Wars Celebration. You've got D23. You've got even the tiny ones, you know, Smallville Con and Top Con. And you look at Starfest out in Denver. They're all over the place. You know, we have almost 1,800 events on our list over at scififorme.com. worldwide events where people get together like this and they express their enthusiasm and their enjoyment for a thing, whether it's a team or a show, or I mean, there are some events that are dedicated specifically to a show. You get Star Trek Las Vegas, Creation Con does, you know, Creation Convention does a number of events for Vampire Diaries and the Originals and Supernatural, and they're all specifically for those shows. There's a Lucifer Con coming in to Los Angeles. These people get together, thousands of people get together to express their appreciation for a thing. And over here, you've got the sports fans getting together for a thing. I heard downtown Kansas City tonight, I think there were something like 15 or 20,000 people at Power and Light District. That's how many people show up at a medium-sized convention. You know, Fan Expo Dallas has, you know, 40 or 50,000 people show up. Planet Comic Con, 80,000 people. You know, Fan X Salt Lake, 175, 180,000 people, 200,000 people. These are big things for the people who have enthusiasm for these things. And it's not just the big crowds. You know, we have our video games, so do they. They've got video games. They play video games. These are sports fans playing video games. And it's not a metal bikini, but, you know, hey, it's close, right? I mean, we got our favorites. You can do celebrity photos. We get photo ops with celebrities. Here's Lady Gaga hamming it up. You know, we get those moments where we can get our picture taken with our favorite celebrity. And there's even cosplay. I mean, really? We've all seen the kids dressed up as Batman and Robin and Deadpool and Han Solo and Darth Vader. Kids cosplay, right? This is not really cosplay, but it's kind of cosplay. I mean, some cosplayers go all out. You know, body paint and the hairstyle and the prosthetics and the makeup and the appliances and the body armor, and they put a lot of effort into this kind of thing. This is the same kind of stuff. This enthusiasm in fandom is not unique to one or the other. Comic book fandom, science fiction fandom. It strikes me that people who say they don't understand one or the other probably understand it a little bit more than they realize that they do, because this is, I mean, look at this. We've even got Patrick Mahomes here doing the Spider-Man homecoming pose. You remember when he was laid out there on the thing, he's relaxing? There it is, right? The enthusiasm that we have as fans for science fiction, for fantasy, for horror should not be denigrated. It should not be dismissed. And that should be true no matter what the entry point for fans. Now, I make the whole sports ball joke. You know, I understand it's football, I understand it's basketball, but it's easy for us to make the joke that it's sports ball and I don't get it. Yuck, yuck, yuck. Okay, fine. But we understand the fandom. We understand the fandom better than we want to admit sometimes. You know, you look at the sports people make fun of the comic book people. And the Star Trek people make fun of the sports people. You know, it goes back and forth, and there's this, not necessarily a rivalry, but there's this, antipathy is too strong of a word. It's a lack of appreciation for those enthusiasms that we have, because it's the same kind of thing. I had an idea one time for a TV promo for us, because this idea of us being fans, we are fans of this stuff, just like all of you are. It just so happens that we have a YouTube channel, and we have a website, and we do this kind of thing, and we are sharing our thoughts and our reviews and the news and whatnot with all of you. Well, I had this idea of, you know, the confrontation setup, where, and I still may do it. I don't know. It would take a lot. Where you have coming down the street, and of course they're moving in slow motion because that's what you do when the group is walking straight toward the camera. You have a bunch of football enthusiasts, and they're wearing the costumes, and they're wearing the face paint, and they're wearing the jerseys, and they've got the foam fingers, and they're all ready to get to the game, right? And then coming toward them from the opposite direction are the geeks, you know, the cosplayers, and they've got their pointed ears and their capes and, you know, their spandex and their props, you know, the big lightsabers and swords and whatnot. And they meet at the bus stop, and it's a stare down. And hadn't quite worked out all the details, but there's a moment where they look at each other and they realize we're all exactly the same. You've got your enthusiasm, we've got ours. You've got your thing that you're really hyped on, we've got ours. And it's the same kind of enthusiasm that we as fans have, and you as fans have, you know, this dichotomy, this chasm that is perceived to be between our fandom and sports fandom really shouldn't be there. And you know, there are a lot of people who like science fiction, who like fantasy, who like horror, who also like sports. They also like, you know, they like football, they like basketball. They're big enthusiasts for both aspects of it. I'm not that big on sports. I can appreciate it. It's not my big thing. But that's me. You know, we've even got trophies. Everybody's got trophies. You know, they've got the Lombardi trophy. We've got the Hugo. Just saying. We're a lot alike. Yeah? We are. Okay, so that's the book that we got. We've unboxed Fractured Tide. So that will go into the pile over here. And actually, since this author is in Fort Worth, I may try to set up an interview with her while we're down at Fan Expo Dallas. We'll see what we can do to make that happen. Because that's something that I want to do more. Is get more interviews done and have things for us to share with you, because we haven't done a whole lot of interviews like I wanted to. Oh, speaking of what I would like to do at some point, did you guys see this? I don't know if y'all saw this or not. Let me dig this up here. Hold on. Bum, 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 bum. We'll put this up because this just launched and it took everybody by surprise. The Expendables Go to Hell graphic novel. Check it out. Story by Sylvester Stallone and Chuck Dixon, art by Graham Nolan. And you'll notice, yes, Richard Meyer is putting this together. He's involved as well. And, of course, you've got, you know, Chuck Dixon, Graham Nolan, the creators of Bane, and Sylvester Stallone. And here's some of the artwork. But look at this. 475% of goal. And this thing just launched. Here, let me get myself out of the way here. Only 706 backers, $47,000. Variant covers, side stories. Basically, the concept is the Expendables are killed in combat. They wake up in hell, and they have to fight monsters. War elephants. Look at that elephant. That's I mean, this is some pretty fun art. Big, giant sandworms there. This is pretty cool. That's a Fokker, I think. It's kind of like the P-51. You know, it's kind of like a Corsair. It's got a bent wing, I think it looks like. It's not a P-51. German version. And dragons. Look at that. This is cool. And it's official. I mean, this is a licensed, official The Expendables story. And you see here multiple covers. Billy Tucci's going to do one. Richard Meyer's going to do one. Jason Johnson's doing one. And of course, they're probably going to have expansion goals, you know, by the time they get down into, you know, stretch goals and whatnot, they're gonna update as they go. This is very cool. The Indiegogo stuff is not going anywhere. This is the big thing now, because DC and Marvel, Image, IDW especially, good lord, they are in so much trouble. I mean, they're hemorrhaging money. I don't know how that company is still in business. Comic books, as a general rule, comic books should be published to entertain people as comic books. Comic books should not exist with the primary reason for existing to be to get a TV or movie deal. It's not what comic books are for. Comic books are to tell a story, not to get you a development deal at the studio. If that's your goal, then go write some scripts and go submit them and let the story department, the script departments of the studios read your scripts, and they decide if they want to do something or not. This mindset in the comics industry right now that, well, I'm going to go do a comic book so I can get the movie deal, is misguided. People should be making comic books for the purpose of making comic books. And a lot of these crowdfunding projects are doing just that. You know, they're not looking for the movie deal. They're looking to make a comic book, a graphic novel, or a series of graphic novels. You know, these guys are not one and done. Richard Meyer is on, I think, project number 3 or 4. Clint Stoker just launched his second Downcast book. This is not going away anytime soon. And it may not be the next Image Comics, but it's the next reaction to an industry that is suffering from a great deal of hubris, especially on the part of DC and Marvel. And when you also factor in the politics, the behind-the-scenes politics, not... There's always... Yeah, you know, the argument could be made that there's been politics in comic books for a long while, but I would argue that they're subtext, not hit you over the head in the face primary piece in the story. Whatever you're writing, whether it's a comic book or a novel, a graphic novel, a movie, a TV show, or whatever, the primary purpose for that kind of thing is to entertain. And if you want to create propaganda for a particular ideology, whatever that may be, you're well within your rights to do that, but admit that you're doing that. You know, just own it. Don't sit there and try to hide behind some other label. You know, if you're gonna propagandize me, then be honest about it. And a lot of the people that are involved in the comics industry right now are not. But I think we're starting to see a little bit of that turnaround, maybe. I don't know. We'll see. It's a little early to tell. But the comics industry is definitely taking notice of this kind of thing. I mean, 47,000 here. Let's see how many projects has he done? He's done, I think, 3 or 4. He's done 7 campaigns. And they've all made bank. And he's gotten involved in other, you know, Kyle Ritter's Starblades, Deathsworn from Carl Rowe, John Malin's Graveyard Shift. See, here's number 2 Graveyard Shift, Ethan Van Sciver with Cyberfrog. You know, you've got Doug Tenable with Earthworm Jim. You have Tim Lim. You have all of these guys. I mean, these guys have been in Donald DeLay, Per Berg. These guys have been in the comics industry. They're professionals. These are not just guys off the street. Here's one from Rob Liefeld, Andrew Huerta. Here's another one from John Malin. These guys are making money. Mitch and Betty Breidweiser. You know, the industry, the professionals, so-called, won't touch any of these guys with a stick anymore because of politics. And it doesn't have anything to do with what kind of stories they tell. It doesn't even have to do with whether they're good at telling stories. It has to do with the fact that I don't like your politics. We're going to blacklist you, and you can't get work in this industry anymore. Okay, fine. We're going to make my own. And that's what they're doing. And they're making hundreds of thousands of dollars on all of this stuff. And we recently heard that Downcast, which is Clint Stoker's first book, or first comic book, rather. He's written some novels, but this was his first comic book. He's got a YouTube channel, Sweetcast. And so his comic book, Downcast, just got a publishing deal from Alterna Comics. And it's going to come out 4 issues in October. So congratulations to Clint. And Richard would have had a publishing deal for his Jawbreakers to go to Antarctic Press, but Mark Waid interfered with that, allegedly. And there's a lawsuit now involved in that, so we'll see how that plays out. Cecil made a ton of money on his project. Let's see where he's at. Let me go back in here, campaigns, because Cecil did this one called Cash Grab, which struck me as kind of being a little bit of a joke, but it's actually, they're actually going to put out a book. Look at this. 17.5%. Oh, you can't see it. There we go. I'm looking at three screens. 17,600% of his goal. $88,000, 1,000 backers. He only did five. You know, this was a gag, I think, and so they're actually going to deliver all of this. But look at that, $88,000. His goal was $500, and he's made $88,000. It's crazy, some of this stuff. Let's look at Downcast, because Downcast, the second Downcast book, here it is, Rise and Fall. This one from Clint Stoker started off with a $5,000 goal. 451%, they're at 22,000. This campaign, when it launched in January, which conventional wisdom up until this point with these things was you don't launch crowdfunding in January or February because you're coming out of the holidays and then, you know, nobody's got any money or whatnot. And Clint went ahead and launched this launched on the same day that Cecil's did, the cash grab project. And this one blew through that $5,000 goal in about an hour and a half. I was online watching it when it happened. But right now he's sitting at 22,000. His other book, his first Downcast book, 31,000. But if you look at the amount of money that's going to these comic books and graphic novels, this here is the same kind of thing. This is the enthusiastic crowd paying for a product, paying to support an industry. And it's not this, you know, it's not any different from buying your favorite team's tchotchkes, you know, the helmet, the football phone, those kind of things. You know, here's Flying Fortress, 34,000. Thrilling Comics, almost 4,800. And they're not even, you know, they didn't make their goal, but they made money. Flying Sparks, 443,000%, or not 443,000, 443%. Let's see if there's any more here. Let's look at comic book. Not all of them are going to do it, but I mean, look at this. Cyberfrog, 538,000, 252,000. By the time all of the Cyberfrog projects are done, he's got over a million. He's made over $1 million. There's 815,000 for Earthworm Jim. These guys are not going away. This is not going away. Now, not all of them are going to be not all of them are going to be great. Not all of them are going to get fully funded, but this shows that there is money to be made. There is an enthusiastic audience that's ready to scoop this stuff up. And it's just the same as your sports fanatics who are going to buy every piece of merchandise for every, you know, I mean, the number of Mahomes shirts that I've seen, everybody's wearing number 15, or they're wearing, wearing Kelsey's number. What is this? Mountaineer Comic Con. This is new. What is that? Raising funds to bring a best-selling to a comic convention. Huh. I wonder if we have they're planning for this in 2021. We're going to have to add this to our list. Mountaineer Comic Con. I wonder if they have a website. It doesn't look like it, but I'll have to do some searching in the tri-state area. North Central West Virginia. I'll have to keep an eye on that. But yeah, this is this is the thing now. This is where it's going. The, you know, the money is there. The industry has turned their backs, collectively, has turned their backs on a number of people who would give them money for a good product. And that's the key. You know, these guys who are doing these crowdfunded projects, they would not be doing more than one if they weren't putting out a product that people liked. You know, I like your book, I'll buy your book, I'll buy your next book because I liked your first book. You know, if I don't like the first book, the second book is not going to make the money. So these guys are clearly doing something that people like, because they're repeating the performance of their previous campaigns. They're making money. The money is there. And it's actually got me thinking about doing something, not a comic book, not a graphic novel, but a magazine. We're thinking. I don't know. See, my biggest thing with all the crowdfunding stuff is, what do we do? What do we get? What are our perks? We don't make a book. We don't make a comic book, you know. So we have to kind of think. I got to think a little bit outside of the box of what kind of things to offer as perks. I mean, do we do pogs? Do we do challenge coins? Do we do pens? Do we do T-shirts, mugs, whatever? You know, and then you know, our main product is the book. How do you make that distinguishable and distinct from the stuff that we do on our website or our .com or our TV stuff? So it's a thinking game right now. We're seeing what's out there. Bling, what was bling? What was that bling? I heard a bling. We have a new follower on our Twitch channel. Look at that. That's very cool. Here, hang on. Let me do this. Boom. See, right there. On up there in the top corner. And watch what happens when this it goes to the Twitch channel. I'm gonna start going into infinity here. Yeah, look at that. Oh, look at that. Boom, 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 boom. Welcome, Tom's Pat. Tom Thompson. I think I know who that is. Welcome, Mike. Thomas. Whoever. No, I'm kidding. I'm kidding. I'm kidding. I'm kidding. We don't, see, I got the name wrong on purpose because we don't dox people. We're not going to sit there and say who you really are. So, but yeah, welcome. Thanks very much for following. That takes us up. Now we've got 67 followers on our Twitch channel. Which, and that's another thing. You know, we've got to figure out if we're going to stay on Twitch, because we haven't had a whole lot of traffic there. Of course, we haven't put a whole lot of time and effort into that. We've got 7 programs, and a lot of them, the live ones go to both channels, YouTube and Twitch, but the pre-produced ones don't always. So we've got to figure out what we're going to do there. We do stream some gaming. Gabe does some, and I've done a little bit. But we've got to figure out what we do with this channel. So I'm open to suggestions. Any of you who are familiar with Twitch, I know it's technically a gaming thing, so our game, it should be an emphasis on gaming over there. I guess we need some gamers to game. See, that's another thing. You know, you've got your people who are really big into TV and movies, and you got people that are big into comic books, and you got people that are big into video games. I'm not a big video game guy. I peaked at the Atari 2600. So for me, it's one of those things where, okay, what games? What games do we play? What's the thing that I'm gonna do? And so yeah, it's been an unusual thing to figure this part out. Why is that interesting? Okay. So we got to figure out what we're going to do with our Twitch channel. And that's a discussion to be had at some point. But anyway. Okay, so a couple of programming notes, and we've posted this in a couple of places there. No H2O podcast tomorrow because, like I said, I got to be over at KU for the basketball. But we do have a brand new Triple Bytes on Tuesday. And then I believe we will have a tartar sauce on Wednesday. So those two things going on this week. And then on Thursday, we'll have an H2O. We've moved H2O from Monday to Thursday this week to accommodate the work schedule and whatnot. So be looking for that. Normally, it's on Monday night. But this week, it's going to be on Thursday. So, and Benjamin, to your point, Cecil made money because people love him because he entertains. I would argue that all of the folks who have made money on these graphic novels, this crowdfunding projects, they've done so because, you know, it's a combination of things. You've got an entertaining personality. You've got an engaging personality. You're good on camera. You're good with your audience, interacting and whatnot. But you're also the product has to be at a level that people like it. They'll buy it again. And these guys are doing that. You know, Cecil's doing it. Donald DeLay's doing it. You know, Tenable's doing it. Mike Miller, Billy Tucci, all of these guys. And it's going to be interesting to see what Mitch and Betty Breitweiser end up doing, because they've got this whole thing going on now with their project that they're doing with Kelsey Shannon and a couple of others that are part of that group. So, yeah, it'll be interesting to see how all of that goes, because it's a thing, and it's not going away anytime soon. And you know, your crowdfunding audience, again, just as enthusiastic, and you know, they'll do fan art and they do fan fiction, and they're you know, coming up with all sorts of ideas for crossovers among all of the different books, and you know, they're buying the pinup posters and the tchotchkes and the stuff. So it's been very interesting to watch over the last couple of years how all of this has grown, and doesn't look like it's going to stop anytime soon. I don't think we've seen the beginning of the end yet. This is the end of the beginning, I think, where you've got people that are into second and third and fourth books in their stories. So and maybe one day we'll have one. We've been talking about doing an Indiegogo campaign for a while, but again, it's one of those things where you got to figure out what are your perks. Our top shelf perk I've already got figured out, and it's a doozy. I love it. And we need to verify a couple of things on that one. But the rest of it, I'm like, what am I going to do? Challenge coins? Pogs? Or those little pop-up things you stick on the back of your phone? Do we use stickers? Do we do t-shirts? You know, it's one of those things. I think I'm in the same place with the crowdfunding model that I was before we started doing podcasts. Because for a very long time, looking back on it is kind of dumb, but for the very long time, I had a creative block on doing podcasts. I'm like, well, how do we do this? Until it kind of seeped into my head, well, it's basically just like radio, only it's radio shows that you download. It's not a live thing. So that made it much easier for us to do that, because I started in radio back in college. But so once I started thinking of it in terms of it being a radio program that just you just listen to whenever you listen to, that made it much easier. And I think for the Indiegogo stuff, for the crowdfunding, it's kind of the same thing. I think at some point there's going to be that one little aha moment where it all just kind of falls into place, and I'm going to say, okay, well, we got this, and we got this, and we got this, and we got this, and we got this. So that's, I hope, anyway. Now, we do have, since we're talking money, we do have a discount set up over at superherostuff.com. You can use the promo code SciFiForMe10. You get 10% off your order. And if you want to support us on a regular basis for financial support, you know, we've got an account over at subscribestar.com where you can pledge. It's like Patreon, only it's not politically motivated as much, and you can join over there and help us that way. But you know, certainly no obligation. Even just you know, Mimi Katz gives us a super chat tonight, and we very, very much appreciate that. And you guys are welcome to do that. But even if it's just leaving a comment, giving us a thumbs up, sharing links to the videos that you like, sharing links to our channel with friends of yours, all of those are different ways that you can support us. Multiverse tonight, Thomas. It's a long march. Eventually make the 125 number for subscribers. Yeah, everybody go check out Multiverse tonight. Go give him a sub and help boost his audience over there. Thomas has helped us in the past. Was actually one of our early hosts of Triple Bytes. Now he's doing his thing and doing fairly well with it. So always good to see one of the children grow up and leave the nest and go on their own and succeed. so we do. Yeah, no, it's good to, it's good that Thomas is doing so well. Speaking of which, we have a new, I haven't gotten there yet. Last week, on Friday, we had a new Ranker Pit. This is, at some point, we're going to go back to doing every other week or the same weeks as we do Salacious Crumbs, which is our Star Wars news program. So that's usually on the second and fourth Monday. And then Ranker Pit will be on the second and fourth Friday. And we're going to do a discussion program for Star Trek at some point, and I'm not ready to tell you the details of that yet, but it's right around the corner, so be watching for that. But if you are a Star Trek fan, don't forget, we do have Triple Bytes that's coming up on Tuesday. It'll be a brand new edition with Meg, and yeah, we've got confirmed media passes for C2E2, confirmed media passes for Fan Expo Dallas. And we've got the reminder that press applications are about to open up for San Diego and WonderCon. And we're waiting for press applications to open up for Star Wars Celebration. That's in Anaheim. So the Subscribe Star, you know, the different things, you know, the money stuff that you guys throw our way, that's what it's going to be used for, is to help pay for travel and accommodations and all that other good stuff. So, and we're hoping that we can start streaming some award shows this year. So lots of things that are on the plate, as it were. We're very excited about. We have a lot of plans. And right now, we're doing all of this. We've got 7 TV shows. We've got the .com. We've got, you know, all of the social media and all of that. We're doing that with 6 people, all volunteers, 6 people doing all of this work. I'm very proud of the team that we have here. And I'm glad that you guys are around to appreciate their work. So we're hoping for bigger numbers. But right now, you know, we're very happy with the crowd that we've got. We're sitting at 1,282 subscribers over on our YouTube channel. That was 1,283 a little bit earlier today, but it fluctuates, goes back and forth. We're that close to 1,300. We're very excited about it. And over on Twitter, such as it is, we are at 2,990 followers. So we don't have that many to go to hit 3,000 there. So if you're not following us on Twitter, you should be following us on Twitter. All right, that's going to do it for us tonight. I'm about talked out, and we've got a long day tomorrow. So thanks very much, everyone, for joining us and being here. And don't forget, give us a thumbs up. If you are watching on replay, you can leave a comment. And make sure if you're subscribed, make sure the notification bell is on, because right now, only 8.2% of you have your notifications turned on. 8.2%. 105 out of our 1,280 some odd subscribers have the notifications turned on. So turn your notifications on so you know when we put our new stuff out, because we put new stuff out every week. And we're trying to stay on a good schedule. We've been pretty good consistent on getting our shows out. So watch your notifications. Get your notifications turned on so you know when we upload. Because every now and again we do a little thing off the cuff, and like for the unboxings and stuff, sometimes in the middle of the day we'll do something. So have your notifications on. Feel free to share our channel with your friends. Inflict us on your enemies, and we will do this again. All right, Benjamin. Well, thank you very much. We appreciate that. And there's no requirement for commenting. We do enjoy hearing from everybody and whatever your thoughts are. But yeah, even just having it on and playing in the background, that helps with the YouTube algorithm as well. So we do appreciate that too. All right, that's going to do it. Thanks very much for watching, folks. Congratulations again to the Kansas City Chiefs. And we will be back here in 1 week. Don't forget, H2O is on Thursday this week, not Monday. Triple Bytes on Tuesday. Bye.
You're watching Sci-Fi for Me TV.